Good afternoon and welcome everybody. Today this is the first session and I'm your coordinator, Dr. Srinivas, and we have two panel discussions and one talk in the first session of today's conference. So the first is a panel discussion on school-going child with persistent jaundice. There's going to be a talk on functional abdominal pain, and this will be followed by a discussion on a toddler with chronic diarrhea. Without wasting much time, let's go on to the first talk or the panel discussion. This panel discussion, the moderator is going to be Dr. Ashish Bavdekar, and the esteemed panelists are Dr. Sadhana Basin Lal and Dr. Vishnu Birada. Let's get to know our speakers of the day. Dr. Ashish knows, he really doesn't need any introduction, but he's a very senior consultant pediatric gastroenterologist. He works at the KEM Hospitals, Pune, and he's got loads of experience, more than almost 20 years of experience. He's also been the ex-president of the pediatric gastroenterology chapter of the IAP, and he's got a very special interest in the metabolic liver disease, especially Wilson's disease. Dr. Ashish also runs a training program called as the ISPGAN Fellowship for 1 year. Dr. Sadhana Basinlal is the consultant pediatric gastroenterologist, a professor and the head of the Division of Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hepatology and Nutrition, DGI MER, Chandigarh. Her special interests are celiac disease, portal hypertension, pancreatitis, and metabolic liver disease. They also run a 3-year training program in DM, in Pediatric Gastroenterology, at PGI MER, Chandigarh. Dr. Vishnu Biradar is a consultant pediatric gastroenterologist at Jupiter Hospitals and Oriana Clinic in Pune. After doing his PBCC at Lucknow, he's also done an observership at the Birmingham Liver Unit, and he's a recipient of the ESPGAN International Travel Exchange Fellowship Award in 2018. His special interests include celiac disease and inflammatory bowel disease. So very dynamic speakers for the day, and I leave Dr. Ashish to take over and proceed with the session.
Good morning, everyone. Our case for today is school-going child with a persistent jaundice. A 10-year-old male child, second child of a third-degree consanguineous marriage, born by LSCS with birth weight of 3 kg, presented with complaints of yellowish discoloration of eyes since 3 months, which were found to increase recently. There were no antenatal or perinatal complications and no record of neonatal jaundice. There was no history of fever, vomiting, pale stools, pruritus, skin involvement, recent blood transfusion, hematemesis, or any symptoms suggestive of bleeding tendency. On physical examination, the child was noted to have pallor and deep icterus. The vitals were normal. There were no facial dysmorphic features. The child was developmentally normal, and the anthropometry showed that the height was 132 centimeter, which lied between 3rd and 15th centile, with a weight of 28 kg, which lies between 15th to 50th centile. On systemic examination, per abdomen showed liver palpable 4 centimeter below the right costal margin, with a span of 13 centimeter, with firm consistency. Splenomegaly was present in this child. The spleen was palpable 3 centimeter below the left costal margin. There was no ascites, and all other systemic examinations were within normal limit.
Yeah, go to the next. So Sadhana, let me ask you a question. With this sort of a history that we have in mind, what are we really thinking of a very initial impressions?
Can I ask a counter question?
Sure.
I would like to know, is there any history of CAM intake in this child? And is there any epidemiologic history? Or you have said there is no fever. So I presume there were no prodromal symptoms. So those are the two things I would like to know.
No prodrome.
And CAM intake?
No. The
alternative, so no.
No.
Now we have a child who has got a 3 months duration of jaundice, which has deepened recently. I presume there is no hepatic encephalopathy, and on clinical examination, there is no ascites. So this would, with a firm large liver. So the diagnostic probabilities in this case would center mostly around a chronic liver disease. I would not seriously like to think of acute liver disease because the duration is more than 3 months. If it were to be an acute hepatitis, then such a prolongation would be consistent with the cholestatic phase, but the child does not have any pruritus, and there is no other complication to suggest that this could be a complicated acute liver acute hepatitis. Systemic disorders could also present with jaundice, but in the absence of fever, in the absence of peripheral lymphadenopathy, I would not consider any of the systemic disorders like TB, Kala-Azar, lymphoma very seriously in this particular child.
Aditya, next slide. So these are the ones that Sadhana has sort of thought about. You mentioned about anorexia or the prodrome. How important is a prodrome in trying to make a diagnosis of acute hepatitis?
No, it is not absolute, because most of the time the prodrome may not be reported. So it is not an absolute. It is not an absolute, but general MBBS teaching, I guess.
Can we say this is not a hemolytic disorder, certainly based on whatever little evidence we have?
From the examination, we've got a small spleen and we have pallor, but no history of any blood transfusion.
Right.
So I would not really consider it very seriously.
Okay.
And however, I would be cautious to say that let us see what is the degree of jaundice. But if I believe the presenter said that, Dr. Aditya said that it was deep icterus, so I would not really consider hemolytic disorder very seriously. If it is a hemolytic disorder, something complicating a hemolytic disorder like a cholelithiasis could be possible, but then that would be associated with pain and fever, which is absent.
Right. Aditya, can you go to the next slide?
Before coming to our institute, the child underwent some prior investigations which showed that he had mild anemia. The platelets were on the lower side and the liver functions were deranged. The serum total bilirubin was 9.6 initially with a direct fraction of 7.2, which over a course of 1 month became 6.2 with a direct fraction of 5.4. The SGOT was 494 and SGPT was 458, which over a month became 283.
So these were the investigations when they came to us. Now, these are the common investigations or liver function the pediatrician does. Vishnu, do you think these are appropriate or these are inadequate?
Vishnu is not audible.
So I think these are inadequate investigations because all of us know that the synthetic function is derived from the albumin and the prothrombin type. And the alkaline phosphatase and GGT, which are important to know about any bile canalicular involvement. So all the components of liver function test should be there when we are evaluating a child with a liver disease. So I would say the PTINR, total protein albumin, alkaline phosphatase and GGT is also must while we are ordering liver function test. So I would like to know all this in this child.
Great. So we did not have this investigation because these were done prior to us, but when the child came to us in June, next slide, Aditya. These are the investigations. Aditya.
The child was noted to have anemia with HB of 7.2, TLC were 14,700 with low platelet count of 98,000. The liver function stayed deranged with serum total bilirubin of 18.6 milligram per deciliter and a direct fraction of 9.2. Since there was a large fraction of unconjugated bilirubin to go with it, we got a peripheral blood smear examination done, which showed no evidences of hemolysis. The reticulocyte count was 9% with a negative direct Coombs test. SGOT was 295, SGPT was 223, alkaline phosphatase was 210, and GGT was found to be 88. The INR on admission was 2.8, which after a dose of 10 milligrams of vitamin K became 2.5. The child had hypoalbuminemia to go with it, with serum albumin of 2.6 and serum globulin of 2.3. The ultrasonography showed diffuse hepatomegaly with a coarse hepatic echo texture, normal appearance of gallbladder. There was splenomegaly with a span of 15 cm. Mild ascites was present, but the renal appearance was completely normal.
So Aditya, can we go back to the previous slide? So Vishnu, you wanted these investigations. I've given you all the investigations you wanted. Can you comment on these?
Yeah, thank you. So with these investigations, now we have to interpret all these investigations. So if you look at the hemogram, it showed a hemoglobin of 7.2 with a retic count of 9% and platelet of 98,000. So there is some element of hypersplenism in this with low hemoglobin and low platelet, and there is some evidence of hemolysis in form of some retic count which is going high. According to, if I corrected the retic count, it will be around 5.5 to 6.
Second 4%.
So the second most thing which is important here, which was missing from the previous investigation, was the prothrombin time. So the prothrombin time is the most important investigation while we are seeing any patients with liver derangement. So that tells us that the liver is functioning well or not. Even in the acute setting, it tells us, is it acute liver failure? And in the chronic setting, it tells us the liver function test is, or the liver synthetic function is going down. The other investigations which we advise or which we ask about is the albumin and total proteins. So the albumin here is 2.6. Again, the albumin half-life is 21 days. So anything less than 3.5, that means this liver disease is a chronic liver disease with a deranged synthetic function. So I would say with this, I would put more money on a chronic liver disease with a decompensated liver disease and hypersplenism. So there is a evidence of portal hypertension on the basis of this blood test also.
Thank you, Vishnu. Next slide, Aditya. Next one. So we had these sort of initial possible differential diagnosis. I think based on the history, the sonography and lab investigations, we are reasonably reached a diagnosis that this child is more likely having a chronic liver disease. And I think all the panelists more or less agree with that. Now, it is not only enough for us to just give that. Now, the question is, how do we move forward? What is the most likely chronic liver disease in this particular situation with this history and at this particular age? Sadhana, do you want to take that further?
Yes, that would be okay. This is a 10-year-old child, basically. So in a 10-year-old with a chronic liver disease, the most likely probabilities are those of Wilson's, autoimmune hepatitis. Without any predisposition, I would not really consider chronic hepatitis B or C causing cirrhosis at this age. And there could be an element of acute and chronic liver disease as well. You've got enzymes which are high. So in the initial investigative workup, I would have also liked to have the viral markers, actually, because it was just about three months down the line. So that would give us a clue about why there is an acute flare of the problem. So this is a male child, and I would like to know, is there any family history of autoimmunity or other systemic autoimmunity in this child?
No family history.
And no hypothyroidism, no other form of autoimmunity in the child. So this is a male child. The most probable diagnosis in this child would be a Wilson's disease.
Possibly. Why did you want to know this history, Sadhana? Can you let us know why you asked for this hypothyroidism, etc.?
Yeah, because though this is a male child, but we do frequently see male children also with autoimmune hepatitis. And a history of autoimmunity can be present in about 20% of these patients. And it is a clue. But overall picture, I would say, would be more likely to be that of Wilson's disease. There is a Coombs negative anemia. Some amount of hemolysis is there. So I would favor a Wilson's disease.
Fine.
No, please go ahead.
So if you are putting Wilson's disease as the top of your diagnosis for now, right?
Yes.
So if you are suspecting Wilson's disease, what investigations would you like to do to make a diagnosis?
So I would definitely want to have the serum seruloplasmin, the serum the KF ring examination, and maybe the 24-hour urinary copper.
Aditya, these are the investigations.
The serum seruloplasmin was found to be 3.2 milligrams per deciliter with a 24-hour urinary copper of 350 microgram, and on ophthalmic examination, bilateral KF rings were present.
Sadhana, go back.
Right. So this virtually clinches the diagnosis of a Wilson's disease even by the classical criteria, that is even without a liver biopsy not showing, without having done a liver biopsy, you've got a very low ceruloplasmin below 5 actually, and a KF ring positivity in the absence of features of cholestasis or acute hepatitis. I'm assuming here that those things are absent. So this would fairly be a clincher for Wilson's disease actually.
So in this situation, liver biopsy was going to be difficult, but suppose it was possible, do you think you would require a liver biopsy, or this is enough to make a diagnosis of Wilson?
This is enough to make a diagnosis of Wilson's disease in this particular case, but there may be situations where the things are equivocal. Your ceruloplasmin is somewhere 18-19, your KF rings are absent, and as a clinician, I would definitely be very cautious about only interpreting on the basis of a 24-hour unit copper, though in this patient it is very high, it is 350, much above the baseline. So in those kind of a plus minus situations, maybe a liver biopsy would be required in the absence of molecular diagnosis. I mean, if you have access to analyzing the ATP B7 genetic mutations, then that could avoid a liver biopsy possibly, but that would be the situation in which a liver biopsy would be required.
Next slide. So as Sadhana has said, this is very classical diagnostic of Wilson disease, whatever we saw in the previous slide, but it's not always that you will get such clear diagnostic investigations. In fact, more often than not, you get investigations that are not very, very typical. And that's why there are a couple of scores that have been devised. There is the Leipzig score by Peter Ferenczi et al. And then there is the Indian modification of this score, which was published last year. And this score basically depends on the presence or absence of KF ring, ceruloplasmin, etc., what is seen on this particular slide. If you have a score of 4 or more, then you generally have a good diagnosis of Wilson's disease. Anything less than that may still be Wilson's disease, but by itself, it is a little difficult to diagnose. If you were to look at the reports of our particular slide here, you will see KF rings were present, so he gets a score of 2. Ceruloplasmin was less than 5, it was 3.2, so there is a score of 3. Urinary copper was high, so it's 2. And there is Coombs negative hemolytic anemia. If you take it, it's 1. So with this, the score is almost coming to around 8, which is definitely very, very difficult and diagnostic of Wilson's disease. Next slide. Now, Vishnu, just assuming that the ceruloplasmin, urinary copper, and KF rings were normal. So the reports that we got previously, just assume for a minute that they were absolutely normal and we could not make a diagnosis of Wilson's disease. What is the role of these other investigations that have been put up on the screen?
I think the differential diagnosis which we put on the first, after the clinical history and the examination, that is it a chronic liver disease? And after that, pointing towards the chronic liver disease, the differential diagnosis were Wilson, autoimmune liver disease, chronic hepatitis B and C. So for these diseases to rule out, let's see autoimmune liver disease. How do we rule out autoimmune liver disease? So we advise to do the serum immunoglobulin G levels, which is quantitative levels, the ANA by IF method with dilution of 1:10, and LCM1 and SMA antibody. So these are the antibodies which will be present in a different types of autoimmune liver disease. And for chronic hepatitis B and C, we advise at least hepatitis B surface antigen and anti-HCV antibody to be done. The other investigations, if we found HBsAg positive, then we advise HBe antigen and anti-HBe antibody and HBV DNA. If anti-HCV is positive, then we advise HCV RNA, and anti-HIV IgM and HIV IgM is to know about the acute insult. But in this case, we are thinking about chronic liver disease. So probably HIV IgM and HIV IgM will not be a diagnostic test for this patient.
Sadhana, you mentioned that you would have wanted a viral marker.
Because if you're saying that if the above parameters of Wilson's are negative, then I would definitely want the viral markers, because you want to arrive at a probability of autoimmune hepatitis, which is the next most likely diagnosis. From that point of view, an absence of a negativity of the viral markers is good to have. That is part of the score, actually. So that would be possible, and I guess you might get a clue that will give you a score. I think if you have viral markers which are negative, that gives you a score of 2. Then serum immunoglobulin, IgG, as Vishnu has pointed out, and the autoantibodies.
Right. So what I understand from both of you is you would say that the two common causes of chronic liver disease in a 10-year-old is Wilson's, you think, as first, generally. Autoimmune hepatitis as number 2. Am I right?
Yeah.
Yes. In case, let's assume these two are also negative, can you just give me very briefly just one or two third and fourth possibilities? You can start with Vishnu and then Sadhana.
So sometimes you have a glycogen storage disease, which glycogen storage disease particularly type 4, but usually they present around 5 to 6 years of age. We see quite a common PFICs, but the history starts from the infancy or from the early childhood, and they have typically itching to start with, and once they advance to the decompensated liver disease, then the itching subsides. So itching will not be a part in the phase of decompensation. So these are the things. Sometimes you have this something called as CASD, cholesterol ester storage disease. So there are different rarer causes we need to find out.
But most of the CSD, GSD are unlikely to be with such high bilirubin levels, right?
Yeah.
Sadhana, none of you are talking much about hepatitis B as a third or fourth possibility. Any particular reason why? Chronic hepatitis B I'm talking about.
I think as we know that in the pediatric age group, vertically transmitted hepatitis B is the most common, and they don't tend to present with a chronic liver disease at this age. They would be in an immune tolerant phase, would have elevation of the HBV DNA with normal enzymes and HBE positivity. So they would be very, very unlikely to present with a hepatosplenomegaly. Horizontally transmitted hepatitis B, especially in an immunosuppressed child, may sometimes present with chronic liver disease, which has a more rapid progress than the other variety. So those situations actually tell you, I mean, they reveal themselves, and you really don't have to think too much about it. But in the general, hepatitis B would not present with a CLD at this particular age, and also same with hepatitis C as well. It would be very, very unusual unless there is a predisposition. And I mean, you have a patient of who's a thalassemic, who's got iron overload and has acquired a hepatitis C, then hepatitis C may be associated. I would not be saying that this would be the cause of chronic liver disease, because the cause of chronic liver disease in that situation would be iron overload. So hepatitis C may be associated with hepatosplenomegaly in that situation. But otherwise, HCV also to cause a CLD, portal hypertension, at this age would be distinctly unusual.
So we are talking go ahead.
Another thing that Vishnu has listed out, all those things, I would tend to agree with you that GSTs and CSTs would not have such high bilirubin unless you have superadded viral hepatitis. If they have superadded viral hepatitis, they can have a more prolonged and a protracted course of an acute viral hepatitis. But then this child, there is a coagulopathy, so those things are out. And also another thing that I would not want to forget is, though, the NAFLD also presents only in the adults as chronic liver disease. It is distinctly unusual, but there is a fraction of children who are morbidly obese may have hepatosplenomegaly and CLD at this age as well. And the other last possibility that I would have come across, especially in a referral institute like ours, is a bud carry with extensive intrahepatic collateralization who is presenting with hepatosplenomegaly and no ascites. So that is the last possibility that I would like.
Right. So Wilson's and autoimmune are definitely number 1 and 2. Unfortunately, what we do find is, whether it's an acute hepatitis or a chronic liver disease, hepatitis B and anti-HCV are the two commonest investigations which are asked by the pediatricians. And we get a number of children with these two reports. of HBSAG and HCV. And as both Dr. Biradar and Dr. Lal have said, they are not the common causes of either acute hepatitis or of chronic liver disease. And especially, at least I would say for hepatitis C, even if you don't do it to start with, is absolutely fine, but it's very unlikely that a pediatrician is going to see either acute or a chronic liver disease because of hepatitis C. Do you both agree?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
I guess those would be more investigations for the at the point of referral when you're trying to make up your mind.
Correct.
But at the baseline, these would not be indicated probably.
Right.
And I would definitely suggest to go ahead and do the Doppler of hepatic vein and IVC when you don't find any other cause. Because as Dr. Sadhana Lal mentioned, and we see in the Western India also that so many cases of bird chiari. So we should always do the Doppler of hepatic vein and IVC.
Yes, that's a good suggestion. Aditya?
Based on these investigations to determine the diagnosis, the ceruloplasmin 24-hour urine copper and KF ring, the diagnosis of Wilson's disease was made.
So we are back to our case now. We had a little bit of discussion of what are the other possibilities if it was not Wilson's. But coming back to our case, now that we have a diagnosis of Wilson's. Next slide. Sadhana, this is, I just put some broad points. Which are the common drugs, diet, supportive management. Without going into absolute details, in this particular child, can you suggest or tell us what you would use as the primary drug? What do you think is the role of the diet? And what do you think are the supportive management lines for this child?
Okay, Dr. Ashish, definitely this is a child who's got severely symptomatic hepatic Wilson's disease. So the as far as I am concerned, the cornerstone of treatment is a strong chelator, and that in our setup is D-penicillamine. So the role of zinc, some people have found good results with combination of D-penicillamine and zinc, especially in patients who are very ill and who have got a decompensated liver disease. But for me, practically, it becomes very difficult because zinc and D-pen can interfere with each other and you have to give a good 5-6 hours gap. So that becomes very, very difficult to implement actually, because you have to give D-penicillamine also fasting. So it's a practical problem to combine the two effectively. As far as diet is concerned, I don't think there is any proven role of diet, especially when you're using a good, a very strong chelating agent. I mean, that would be, I don't think it would, a strict dietary control is necessary, but it is prudent, I think, to advise them to lay off the high copper containing foods like nuts and shellfish and organ meats. Specifically soy maybe. So that would be a good idea. But you, it cannot be said to be, I mean, you needn't actually restrict it very assertively. And supportive management obviously is that for the nutrition. You have to take care in a big way with ensuring the protein intake, take care of the ascites. In this child, fortunately, you have got very high bilirubin, you've got evidence of some hemolysis, and you've got an INR which is 2.8, but very luckily he has very mild ascites, so I would give him a very good prognosis with medical therapy alone, specifically D-penicillin.
What about, would you like to screen the siblings?
Oh, yes, definitely. I think there is a third degree consanguinity here. That is absolutely a must to screen the siblings of this child. With the serum ceruloplasmin LFT and further as required, depending upon what you find.
So what is the risk of a sibling having Wilson's disease?
So there would be a 25%
risk. 25%
risk.
And what are the investigations you would like to do in the sibling, and from what age will you start?
I guess in a sibling, it's it's fruitless pointing to in an asymptomatic sibling who is absolutely having no hepatosplenomegaly. It may not be necessary to screen before the age of 3 or 4. But otherwise, if you discover on clinical examination, sonography, or on LFT, you discover abnormality, then definitely it has to be screened. Otherwise, all asymptomatic siblings above the age of 3 possibly need to be screened.
So you would do a ceruloplasmin, a urinary copper, liver function test, sonography,
and
all siblings, a 3 years plus,
yes.
Definitely and, you would.
Yeah.
Okay. Now this child is, as you said, he's not really decompensating, though the history has been for a reasonably long time. is likely to do well with medicines, but sometimes some children come to us with Wilson's who are really in end-stage liver disease. So in which situations, Vishnu, will you go in for a liver transplant in a case of Wilson's disease?
I think what we have learned in last two decades, that all Wilson's, those who had a PTINR of 2.5, 3, 3.5, we initially thought that we should be transplanting them. But now with medical management, we know it takes at least 3 to 6 months for the PTINR and all parameters to come back to the normal. So we should give adequate time. But saying so, there are certain situations where we know that in spite of all the medical management, we will not be able to salvage this child. So the Wilson disease presenting with encephalopathy, in those children, I would not like to wait. Wilson disease with a refractory ascites with a serious infections like spontaneous bacterial peritonitis, 2 infections in last 6 months or so. So I know that with each infection, this child will have a more severe course, and the refractory ascites, if it is not getting better, then unlikely this child is going to be managed on the medical line. But I would definitely give a 3 to 6 months before I would like to think about the liver transplant. So these are the 2-3 things I would like to tell. But one more point for the pediatricians in the supportive management, we always see that the pediatricians are very reluctant to give a high protein diet or good amount of protein diet in chronic liver disease. The previous teaching was that we should be restricting the protein, but in a compensated liver disease, we should not restrict this, the protein, and the child should be getting 2.5 to 3 grams per kg protein per day, and including the non-veg sources. I don't find any problem. In this child, Wilson, we will not advise non-veg, but the eggs and all the things are allowed for this child as far as the protein intake is concerned.
Thank you, Vishnu. Next slide. So take home messages for the pediatricians is, please remember the clinical and laboratory features which may suggest a chronic liver disease in a child with jaundice. Next slide. On the basis of history, absence of prodrome as mentioned, deep jaundice, persistent jaundice, form hepatosplenomegaly, significant ascites, and especially recurrent episodes of jaundice should make you suspect that this is not a plain simple case of acute hepatitis, but likely or possibly may require investigations for chronic liver disease. Next slide. As described again in the panel discussion, what we have here is, if you have a bilirubin which shows a large unconjugated fraction, think that there is possible hemolysis. An ALT, AST that is not in 500 or thousands is something that you put you in your card. If your alkaline phosphatase or your GGT is disproportionately raised as compared to your ALT, AST, think of a cholestatic disorder which is possibly chronic in origin. Look for low albumin, which is a synthetic function test, but also look for high globulins, which may in some situations suggest the possibility that this may be autoimmune hepatitis. And INR, which is prolonged despite vitamin K, is something that should always put you on a guard that this child is going to come into deep trouble. Next slide. Also remember that hepatitis B and C are not the commonest causes of chronic liver disease. Wilson's disease and autoimmune hepatitis in a 10-year-old child are. So these are the things that you should investigate for when you get an older child after the age of 5 to 6 years. Also remember that if you pick up these disorders very early, there is good medical management available, whether it's Wilson's or autoimmune. So it is absolutely essential that we don't wait for these children to deteriorate further. However, all of us know that we get children coming to us quite late. And in these sort of situations, sometimes only a liver transplant may be the option, of course, depending on the affordability of this child. I think we will stop this session over here. I would like to thank Aditya for presenting the case, Dr. Sadhana Lal and Dr. Vishnu Biradar for helping in this discussion and coming out with the key points which are important whenever we look at suspecting an older child with chronic liver disease. Thank you.